Views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to the revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. All right. So yesterday we had the budget communication, right? And I was frustrated with the structure of it in terms of getting to the meat and potatoes of things. And I, you know, and then, and also, you know, Dr. Minnis is just not a good speaker, so it's all the more frustrating. But we now can understand more clearly what's in the budget. Okay? Communication was a flop for me. I've never heard any budget communication that made my hair stand on edge, but this one frustrated me because of where we are and the slapping up in terms of disparate themes and all this. But, you know, hey, that's a matter of just delivery, writing. Those are aesthetics. The actual numbers are what we're interested in, and the actual strategic aims of the budget and whether we actually think that the budget is undergirded by data that is empirical, that this isn't just a game where you're playing out with numbers. Because here's what's true. We're in a extremely precarious situation in terms of our debt and in terms of our economic contraction. So no government that I'm aware of has ever been precisely on target with its revenue projections, because you can't always be accurate with that, because you really don't know what the economy is gonna do. All right, you can guess, you can estimate, you can forecast, you can look at it, but you really don't know. So no one's ever been on target. But this administration has missed the mark of its projections every single time. All right? In order of sometimes hundreds of millions of dollars. So to the extent that this doesn't bear out is the extent to which we are in that much greater trouble. So this is a balancing act, a tightrope act. Now, you ain't got to guess with me, because I'm going to lay out something for you. You ain't got to guess with me. Some of y'all are sensitive, right? But let me just outline where I am so that you know that you ain't got to guess, right? So do I believe that Dr. Hubert Minnis is a good prime minister? No, I don't. Do I believe he knows what he's doing in the Ministry of Finance? No, I do not, all right? But does that mean I have a problem with the Minnis administration as a government? No, I do not. I'm going to examine what they do, and as far as they're in control of the public purse and my tax dollars are on the line, then we're going to critically examine what they do. Now, you could take criticism or critique or analysis as being negative, whatever you like. You deal with your sensitivity. But you don't have to guess with me. I'm pulling no one way or the other. I don't think Dr. Minnis is a good prime minister, but I don't have a major problem with the Minnis administration in and of itself. All right? So we ain't got to guess. He knows that. You know that. I'm sure his opinion of me is not that high in terms of my professional career, but it is what it is. So this is the position that the Nassau Guardian's editorial board took about the budget and the communication, all right? And I did not write this, by the way. So this is called, and I agree with this, and so that's why I want to read it for you to understand where we are in terms of framing this budget in a larger context and the reality of where we are, okay? So this is called Acceleration Without a Strategy. It says, with the national debt reaching $9.86 billion as of December 2020, and $9.42 billion in government debt versus a $9.67 billion real gross domestic product, putting government debt to GDP for 2020 at 97.4%, the laying out of a tangible debt management strategy in yesterday's budget communication was imperative. That strategy was not provided in the presentation of what was predictably an election budget. Government debt is projected to reach $10.4 billion at the end of the upcoming fiscal year. And the Minnesota administration is seeking a new $1.85 billion borrowing envelope following $2.4 billion in borrowing during the first 9 months of the current fiscal year, which led to a $100 million increase in debt services charges during the period. Instead of a debt management strategy, a pledge to deliver one later this year was offered by the Prime Minister as he presented budget projections with direct implications for the country's debt position that, by current indicators, are optimistic at best. Though the Department of Statistics puts nominal GDP for 2020 at $9.91 billion, the Minnesota administration projects nominal GDP for fiscal year 2020-2021 will come in at $10.8 billion. Statistics puts estimated real GDP contraction for 2020 at 14.5%, while the administration projects a contraction in real GDP of 5.8% for the current fiscal year. Minnesota announced that recurrent deficits for the current and upcoming fiscal year are now projected to come in at $1.3 billion and $954 million, respectively. These projections, however, are contingent upon government meeting its revenue targets. This has not happened even prior to Hurricane Dorian. As of March, government was $426.5 million from its total revenue estimate, $196.5 million away from its value-added tax estimate, and $32 million shy of its excise tax estimate for the current fiscal year. Yet, with the announcement of new revenue measures, forgoing a yet-to-be-quantified level of taxes in the upcoming fiscal year, the Minnesota administration says it expects to collect $588.3 million more in total revenue than the current year, $179 million of which would be value-added taxes, $74 million of which would be excise taxes. To lower a deficit, you can cut expenditure. Though we see a $100 million annual reduction in subventions over the next 4 years was targeted for cash-burning state-owned enterprises, with $21 million in savings budgeted for the current fiscal year, the Prime Minister announced that the plan was deferred to retain staff levels. Meanwhile, capital outlays falling hundreds of millions below yearly estimates continue to provide an artificial holding of the recurrent deficit to its projected levels. This is increasing future costs due to inadequate maintenance of public infrastructure and limited opportunities for economic activity. The International Monetary Fund projects 2% growth in real GDP in 2021, while the Minnis administration projects real GDP will grow by 3.9%. Government appears to be banking on robust tourism inflows due in part to cruise line homeporting scheduled to begin in June. The World Tourism Organization has outlined two scenarios for a rebound in international tourist travel for 2021. The first being a July rebound, leading to a 66% increase in international arrivals this year. And the second, a September rebound, resulting in a 22% increase in visitor arrivals. A 2020 survey by Cruise Lines International Association, which represents 95% of the world's ocean-going cruise capacity, found that 74% of cruisers were likely to cruise in the next few years, and 2 out of 3 cruisers were willing to cruise within another year. Given the uncertainties that continue to exist for global travel as the pandemic rages on, wagering the tourism inflows will be sufficient to satisfy budget projections and government obligations does not qualify as an economic growth strategy. Nationwide unemployment figures, which are a key economic indicator, have not been available since May of 2019. And seeking to address pervasive joblessness, the Prime Minister announced a $40 million VAT incentive program the administration hopes will put 2,500 people back to work in the upcoming fiscal year. It is a band-aid measure in government's accelerated Bahamas budget that falls woefully short of what remains a critical need for the laying out of an economic and debt strategy that must be driven by more than hope. All right? And there the editorial ends, and I agree with the editorial. And so that's where we are in terms of what we heard yesterday. All right? To keep it blunt, I don't believe that the government is going to collect the revenue it says it is going to collect. I don't believe that the projects that they have budgeted will come in at the prices that they have budgeted them. I don't believe that the government has any empirical data, though I'd love to see it if they do, that they can actually collect an additional $14 million in real property taxes off of what they say is a $9 billion additional in taxable property on New Providence because of a valuation exercise. I don't believe the economy is going to grow at 4.2%. All right? So, understanding that, let's look at some of the things that we saw and try to rationalize the government's thinking and understand what the outcome may likely be. So, the government is proposing a series of tax breaks. All right. At the same time, the government has dramatically increased the spending for salaries and contract workers in the upcoming budget. You can go through every head and see it. Right? In one instance, they had a several million dollar variation in what they're allocating for these different heads. So at the same time, you're talking tax breaks, which means you're going to lose revenue, and you're talking increasing expenditure, particularly in terms of hiring. It looks like they're going to do quite a bit of hiring. All right? Now, here's the issue with this. And I hope the cocktail of things that could go wrong doesn't bear out. But the issue is this. When you're speaking during the budget communication, right, you're not just talking to me, right? You're not just talking to your supporters. Every law firm will have someone watching the budget communication and will forensically examine the budget. Every accounting firm in this country will have someone watching the budget, all right, communication and examining the documents. They'll examine every piece of legislation. They'll examine every measure. Every bank will watch the budget, examine every measure, will forensically go through the budget. Our international credit ratings agencies will watch, will examine the budget. Our international lenders will watch and examine the budget. So you're telegraphing certain things that I fear may end up putting us in a weird position. So you are projecting revenue from a global tourism market that is still in the doldrums, that international agencies are intimately familiar with. They will hedge on the side of caution in terms of global tourism growth, and they are likely not to believe that you're going to have the kind of fiscal growth that you're projecting. They'll likely not believe that you will collect these sorts of tourism, these revenues that you're projecting. All right? At the same time, you are ramping up spending by $270 million. So I don't think the IMF is going to believe you. I don't think the IDB is going to believe you. And I certainly don't think the credit ratings agencies are going to believe you, because they know us. They know this is an election year. They know what the Bahamas historically does during election years, which is ramp up spending. But this is not the normal world situation economically. So as you seek to borrow, you table a resolution to borrow $871 million. You're going to, I guess, refinance another $900 million in debt, is what it looks like, because you are asking for a projecting a $1.8 billion total borrowing. So they'll refinance, pay some off, and everything. It'll net come out 900 and something. But the money is going to get more expensive to borrow, because you're likely to get downgraded. You're likely to not get a good economic outlook, particularly in light of the fact that the IMF has asked that we seriously look at structural public sector reform. Now, the Prime Minister said yesterday, well, we had an audit and it's about done, so we'll, okay, that the IDB is helping them with. They've asked that you look at public sector structural reform, which means they want you to have a more efficient public sector. You're probably duplicating services. They want you to maybe not have so many people on the public payroll. You're doing the opposite of that. The IMF has asked you, as well as the credit rating agencies have noted, that we have a group of state-owned enterprises that is a drain on the public sector. They've asked you to reform those. They've asked you to bring those more towards self-sufficiency so they're not using government funds so heavily. You are doing the exact opposite of that in order to save jobs. Right? So you've already spent almost $40 million on Bahamas Air. Who knows what that'll come in at? And you're planning on spending much more on that, on it in the upcoming year. So these indicators don't bode well for how this is all going to turn out. We, this fiscal year, have a debt service bill of $500 million. And I said this yesterday, that's more than any ministry in the budget, right? That's our biggest bill. That's the debt ministry. Right? That's the biggest one. Now, what may happen is that the money gets more expensive to borrow and your debt service charges actually go up dramatically, because $100 million in 1 year is dramatic. It's a dramatic situation. Dramatic things happen, right? I don't want to hear this old adage about, well, you had to borrow and all that. Of course you had to borrow. That's fine. I get it. We had to. Yeah, that's right. Nobody's arguing that, right? We don't need to dredge that back up. They borrowed. They had to get the money from somewhere. The money wasn't coming from tourism. They had to borrow, right? The problem is, if you're borrowing this money, you got to get clear indications of how to pay this off, right? And as it stands, we don't have clear indications of how this is going to get paid off. Now, the Ministry of Finance is having a press conference right now, so maybe they're explaining to us how this will all pay off, and maybe we'll get a transparent route to paying down this debt. But it's doubtful. Why do I say it's doubtful? It's doubtful because you don't do what you say you're going to do. So in your 9-month fiscal snapshot, you published a list of bills that you say is going to help with fiscal prudence, fiscal transparency. The Public Debt Management Act, the Public Procurement Bill Act, all right? And two other acts, right? The National Statistics Institute Bill and the Financial Management Bill, which replaces the key parts of the Financial Audit and Administration Act, all right? You haven't brought regulations for these. You promised to bring the regulations for the Debt Management Act and the Financial Management Act. No one tabled Debt Management Act regulations yesterday. So there's no regulations. So you're saying that the strategy is coming out later this year. So legally it's November. So we need to wait until November to understand where we are. This is a mistake, in my opinion. All right? That's where we're looking at in terms of if they meet their revenue projections. Now, let's outline what the Prime Minister has said that they're looking at for tax breaks. And see, when you're doing this thing, you got to be strategic, right? You don't just do it for party favors. You do it because you really think and you really have some indicators that there's economic viability, all right, in these areas. So again, you talked about the real property tax, and you're saying $14 million, but last time you told me that you were going to collect much more real property tax than you did, right? Your measures fell short. You talked about gaming tax, and then you fell short. Now your tax on gaming winnings is in court, and so you fell short. You don't have the money. So you could plan out these things, but unless you have a real way to get there, you got to be realistic with your projections. They're projections. I get it. They're estimates, right? It's not an exacting science, but you got to be realistic with it. And I don't believe that so far the administration has been realistic with itself in terms of what it actually can capture in revenue. All right? So the Prime Minister yesterday announced that they're eliminating value-added tax on baby and adult diapers, sanitary pads, tampons. It says, let me ask you this. Do you have to say for women when you say tampons? Or do you? Because I don't know that anyway. This says he also announced the elimination of duty on items, including disinfectants, to maintain hygiene and sanitation. All right, and that's fine. By application for construction and repairs to churches and other buildings used for religious gatherings, on a range of sport equipment and apparatus to encourage exercise and fitness, and a number of IT-related hardware and cabling to support private sector digitization efforts. Hey, that's good, right? This is a good thing. That's fine. But you're losing revenue. That's good. It can spur some economic activity, possibly. But you're losing revenue. So you got to figure out, if I'm doing this, where do I make up the revenue? Right? Remember, this was the question asked when the PLP said you're going to lower it from 12 to 10. Where do you make up the revenue? All right. This says he also says there will be a reduction in the duty on a number of building supplies to 20 and 25%. Now, here's my issue with this, right? And that sounds good. That there's a reduction on duty and building supplies to 20 and 25%. I don't know what you're reducing the duty on, which building supplies you're reducing the duty on, but here's the issue with that. The price of construction materials due to the disruption in global supply chains has skyrocketed. All right? On average, I was reading 50 to 70%. So that's an incentive for me to build. the tax break, but the fact that construction materials have skyrocketed in price and take longer to get here and it's more of a hassle to build is likely to dissuade many people from building at this time until we have some sort of economic recovery on the global market until supply chains get sorted out. So you may not want to build in the next fiscal year. You may want to wait a year. So does this in effect actually help the construction industry? Because of the cost and the acceleration of building supplies, I also strongly doubt that they will be able to build another block at Princess Margaret Hospital for $70 million. The last block they built was $100 million. All right? And that was almost 10 years ago. After they built that block, they had to borrow another $100 million plus to outfit it. Now you're telling me you're going to build another block that's state-of-the-art, that's more advanced, 10 years later with construction prices radically higher for less money than the last block. And so I don't buy it. And I don't buy you're going to have spend $21 million on the Rand Memorial. Now, I don't know, and there's no contract yet, so it would be interesting to see if how that bidding process goes and what people say they can actually build for $70 million. But I highly doubt it's going to be anywhere near the size of the critical care block because just things have changed. All right? Now, the Prime Minister also announced that there will be special economic recovery zones in the southern, in islands in the southern Bahamas. All right? Grand Bahama and Abaco will be a recovery zone. Right? And now you're going to create special economic zones in islands in the southern Bahamas. You're also eliminating duty on, or VAT, on purchases in the family lines over $250,000. But the issue is that, or under $250,000, but the issue is that if I'm building a house and I'm a first-time homeowner in the Bahamas, I already have an exemption on under $250,000. Now, maybe you're thinking someone's going to go build a second home, but you just heard what I just said about construction materials. I don't know that the reduction from 20 to 25% is going to offset the 50 to 70% cost that I read that construction materials went up by. Plus, there's a great delay in getting stuff. I know a lady who is renovating her house, and she pushed through that during the pandemic, and she's had to wait 4 or 5 months for tiles, right? She could maybe have gotten some tiles she didn't like and put them in her house, but you got to live with them forever. So she was like, I'm going to wait for the tiles I want. They told me 4 to 5 months. I'm waiting. So these are good things that can help some people, but I don't know that you're going to realize the impact from them. All right. Oh, we got a break? Okay, let's take a break, and we'll be back on the other side.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Everyone should experience a brand new car, but not everyone can afford one. Until now, Bahamas Bus and Truck has the answer. The stylish, spacious, feature-rich, yet affordable Mitsubishi Attrage. Priced at $21,900, including a 3-year warranty, why not come and experience the value that Mitsubishi has built into the Attrage today? Bahamas Bus and Truck, the country's only authorized Mitsubishi dealer. Telephone 322-1722.
Sourdough King is back at Burger King Nassau. This fan favorite features 2 quarter-pound savory flame-grilled beef patties topped with thick-cut smoked bacon, 4 slices of melted American cheese, ketchup, and creamy mayonnaise, all on toasted sourdough slices. Get your sourdough sandwich as a single or a double and add ice-cold Pepsi and fries or onion rings for a perfect way to fill your day. The flame-grilled Sourdough King is only here for a limited time and only available at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. I'm Juan McCartney, so good to have you with us. All right, what we're doing is we're assessing the budget, right? Now, again, your feelings don't really matter to me. Like, you know, if you feel like, oh, don't critic the Prime Minister. Look, this is the government, all right? If the government doesn't get this right, the country suffers. I'm looking at your measures, and I'm asking, are these based in reality? Because if you don't hit these marks, and you proceed to continue to spend as planned, it's going to be problems, right? Now, for the past several years, you've not spent on capital works as you said you would in order to reduce the deficit to come in at your numbers. You've had to not engage in a particular raft of capital spending. You're not going to be able to do that this year, because an election is on the line. So you're going to spend this money, right? And probably more. So if you don't realize this revenue, it's going to be a problem. All right? Let me, before we get into that, we'll get into some of the other stuff on the other side. Let me do some of your text messages. Good day, Juan. 3 straight, F&M, 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 no. That's fine, you know. If you like the F&M, that's fine, right? That's perfectly okay, and I'm happy for you, but what I want you to do is to look at this thing realistically, all right? Don't sell dreams now. Let's look at it realistically, how it's going to work. It says, one, the PM touted the $100 million for healthcare. Words matter. Why do I say that? He said some $19 million about they're budgeted, but he said some $70 million targeted for PMH. Well, that means, on my view, PMH may or may not get $70 million. So that $100 million is not set in stone, so let's not jump up and say $100 million for healthcare. As I said, I don't know what kind of block they're going to build at PMH for $70 million, but it ain't going to look like the critical care block and have all the stuff the critical care block have in it. Not for $70 million. Not right up and now. And they say they're trying to build this within 18 to 24 months. I don't think that's going to happen, but if you make that push like that, you have to pay market prices, straight up. Well, and trust me, we are witnessing the dumbest minister of finance our country's ever had. Oh, boy. It says, I have no confidence in our country's leadership. Do you know why ministries are getting more money in light of our economic state? It makes no sense. They're hiring. He said yesterday they will be hiring. All right. After a freeze on a so-called freeze on hiring for numerous years, right? After the worst economic crash of this, right? Of the last 100 years, right? Or since 1930s. After the worst economic contraction that any of us has seen in our lifetime, you're now lifting the freeze on hiring and ramping up hiring. And that only can be because of the election, okay? So just say what it is. You know who I respect for calling it like it is? Ingram, right? So when Ingram did the job program at the end of 12. Ingram said it is what it is, right? As we want give people jobs, and it is what it is. And he was straight up with it. So say it is what it is. Well, since PI let go 700 people, that makes government the major employer for the whole country. Government workers do not create wealth. They deflate wealth. If we have only, say, 40% of our country creating wealth and 60% deflating it, that ain't going to work. That is exactly what happened to Greece. They went bankrupt because 55% of the population worked for the government. Yeah, the government's already the major employer. Even if Atlantis doubled its workforce, the government would still be the major employer of the country. So that's not anything. Yeah, Atlantis letting go 700. Don't shift the balance of where this is. It says, I'd advise Bemis to take advantage of the incentives that's in the budget. Don't allow politics to blind your judgment. Don't mind those who are criticizing, looking for cheap political brownie points because you miss out on these opportunities. No. I mean, of course, take advantage of the opportunities in the budget. Who doesn't want to take advantage of a tax break? But I'm saying, is there critical mass in the economy to realize the revenue you're saying these tax incentives will generate? Or the tax hikes? Is there critical mass in the economy for people to take advantage of this in a meaningful way? Or are people still halfway knocked out and won't be able to take advantage of it? Because I certainly wouldn't be building no house right now. Not if you look at construction material prices. I'm sorry, we can take the call, you know, everything cool. You can call me, 323-6232. 323-6232. 325-4316 and 325-4259. All right? So, for instance, we talked about this. The government said it's going to expand special economic zones to include southern islands. All right? So, currently, Grand Bahama is a special economic zone. Currently, Abaco is a special economic zone. Those are our second and third largest economies in this country. Has the special economic zone in Abaco and Grand Bahama led to any sort of real growth in Abaco and Grand Bahama? So what, in your mind, leads you to believe that there is some sort of pent-up desire to invest in building on family islands or expansion in family islands that would lead to generating any sort of real growth in those areas? Because we already have a Family Island Encouragement Act, and still there's no growth. What have you looked at to say that people want to start industry in Mai-Khao, right? What is going to be there, right? What sort of major employer is seeking to move to San Salvador? because Club Med's not coming back till next year. Maybe they'll take advantage. All right. Now, again, so someone's telling me they're going to go pay their real property tax. Take advantage. If you're in a position to take advantage of tax incentives, then by all means do so. That's not the thrust of what I'm talking about. My thing is, will what you are saying realize what you're projecting? That's my thing. All right? It says, Juan, do they allow the import of masks yet? Because these disposable masks are real expensive and to come online. Yeah. It says, Juan, so the PM gives a deflated price to construct a new block at PMH. If the FNM were to lose the election and new government completes the block at market value, think the new government will be viewed as corrupt for spending more than the originally quoted cost? No, and ain't nobody talking about corruption, you know. I'm talking about it don't ever cost what you say it can cost. Hardly ever, right? So the Paul Adley building costs probably 10 times what they had budgeted for it. The Orville Turnquest building went way over budget. When do y'all bring in projects in government on budget? I'm so confused. In addition to that, there's a global supply chain problem that's driving up construction costs. I just is not realistic to me to say you can have something modern, the next phase is going to look anything like the critical care block, not for $70 million. Well, on tax breaks and increased government spending is always a recipe for economic disaster. I understand we're now within 1 year of an election and the government is trying to get reelected, but either budget year 2022 or 2023 or 2023-24 will be a budget we will never forget. We're not focused about our future as a country. Some serious restructuring is needed, and it's clear this government doesn't have the will to do it. How many times are you going to borrow to pay back a previous borrow at a higher interest rate? This is going to get unfeasible at some point shortly. I miss Peter Turnquest. Yeah. And you're facing a debt avalanche here shortly, right? So it is what it is. You had to borrow. You chose to go about it this way. I don't believe you had to do that level of borrowing in foreign currency to protect the peg. That's always been at about $1 billion. We've always been about, 14 months or so of import during normal times. These are not normal times. There's no tourists here. People aren't going to be asking for foreign currency to import goods to feed the tourists and take care of the tourists because there ain't no tourists. Now, when the tourists come back, you can see those foreign reserves shrink. All right? And then you're going to be possibly challenged in the future when you have these balloon payments, these principal balloon payments due, to find that foreign currency. All right? You could get it. You just get paid for it. All right, we got to take a break for the news. We'll be back, and we'll talk some more about what was presented when we return.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the Guardian News Network. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's the news at 1 o'clock. It is Thursday, May 27th, 2021. Thank you for tuning in. Government signed a $1.9 million contract today with Multimedia Technologies for Marco's Alert System. The Mandatory Action Rescuing Children Operation Alert System will send emergency notices to mobile users on both local networks. It's named after Marco Archer, who disappeared and was murdered in 2011. National Security Minister Marvin Dames speaking to Marco's sister, Tanzia Humes, and said it was important to live up to the commitment made to the family.
This must be a very good day for you, but we want to ensure that we live up to the commitment that would have been made. And now, every time there is an alert and you pick up your phone, you would know that's a Marco's alert. And that's unfortunately as a result of a tragic incident. to a young man at a very tender age. But what it does, too, is that it certainly, you know, brings it full circle.
Marco Archer would have been 21 years old today. Ralph Walker, CEO of Multimedia Technologies, explaining a little about the technology being used.
This technology has been deployed throughout North America as well as Europe. And I'd like to say that the Bahamas is among the first to really deploy it in the Caribbean. The underlying technology is based on a technology called cell broadcast, which allows public warning messages to be reached at specific areas within the Bahamas or even the entire population within seconds.
Earlier this year, Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis announced 4 digital billboards had been erected across New Providence to send out warnings as part of the rollout, and information about missing children would be broadcast on billboards, including one at Lyndon Pindling International Airport, the junction of Chippingham Road and West Bay Street, Arm Bailey Park, and S.C. McPherson School on Blue Hill Road.
These contract signings here this morning are very important. And as a government, we understand the importance and the significance of these contract signings, certainly to the safety and security of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Every citizen, every visitor is important to us. And we want to be able to ensure that no matter where they live, where they sleep, where they play, that we can provide that feeling of comfort, that they can be secured and safe.
The budget allocations for 49 government ministries and departments projected to see increases in the upcoming fiscal year. The total allocation for recurrent expenditure stands at $2.83 billion, nearly every ministry and department seeing its budget increase. The Ministry of Tourism and Aviation saw its budget increase by $34.5 million to $140.5 million. Social Services seeing an increase up $21.1 million to $81.4 million. Public Service and National Insurance increasing by $42.8 million, now $306 million. The Office of the Attorney General and Ministry of Legal Affairs increasing by $3 million to $18 million. Parliamentary Registration Department increasing by $3.1 million to $4.7 million. National Security's budget has increased by $4.7 million, there are $12 million now. The Ministry of Public Works saw its budget increase by $6.2 million to $47.7 million. The Office of the Governor General and staff's budget increased from $962,891 to over $1 million. The House of Assembly saw a marginal increase in its budget, only $6,695, as did the Cabinet Office, $31,978, and several other ministries and departments. Well, government's tax breaks for small and expanding business will include duty-free concessions for their first stock of inventory. It's very welcome news to business owner Raquel Dean. She started her company at the height of the pandemic. Here's Jillian Gray.
Being a blooming business, it's a good opportunity to expand our horizons. Mm-hmm. I know with working with food, a lot of persons are now in the food market. And sometimes when I go to buy certain products locally, they're unavailable. Mm-hmm. So now with this opportunity, now affords me the opportunity to go abroad and bring my stuff in.
For businesses that make less than $5 million annually, the Small Business Tax Concession and Relief Program will provide duty-free concessions on all items needed to start or expand a business. Dean says she's looking forward to eventually acquiring a storefront and hopes that other businesses take advantage of this opportunity.
We started essentially during the pandemic. It was something that I wasn't even thinking of doing, and when God gives you an opportunity, you have to take it. Mm-hmm. So now he's giving us an even further opportunity. So we have to take it, mm-hmm. and we have to be able to expand. So it kind of holds you to it and makes you accountable, because sometimes we get so comfortable in our comfort zone. So it now says, okay, go out there and do what you have to do. Mm-hmm. So we're thankful for that opportunity.
For CBS Bahamas Vice President Brent Burrows, the incentives couldn't have come at a better time as they're about to open a new location.
One of the issues we have in our business is that people compare our pricing directly to the United States. So the lower we can get our prices to be equal to the United States, the better off for us. So people generally, a lot of people don't add in that duty factor when they're comparing prices. That'll be a huge factor for us.
However, he's concerned about the incentives offered to churches and family islanders and how those concessions will affect small businesses. He's encouraging the government to partner with small businesses to discuss how everyone can benefit.
As soon as a consumer hears it's duty-free, their first reaction, I have to go to Florida and shop for that to bring it in duty-free. That's not correct. CVS has been doing duty-free for very large products for 25, 30 years. But the government needs to work with us to see how we can bring in product duty-free that we could then sell to the consumer who qualify as duty-free purchases, that we can sell to them duty-free products.
Now, added to those duty breaks is the Employment Incentive Program, which will give businesses a $400 VAT break per week per employee for up to 10 new employees as of July 1st. Both Burroughs and Dean say they'll be looking to add employees and take advantage of that incentive.
So that gives businesses a reason to go out and look for employees, especially those that have been putting that off because of the economic climate.
We do need more staffing as we expand, so this is also a good opportunity as well to employ some persons into the workforce, because I know a lot of persons were impacted during the COVID. So it's such a great joy to be able to help someone or other persons to be able to find a job.
For the Guardian News Network, I'm Jillian Gray.
Medicinal cannabis will only be allowed to be smoked in a private residence or a medical facility, according to a recent draft of the Medicinal Cannabis Bill 2021. It would be considered an offense for a patient to smoke medicinal cannabis outside these areas. As a result, the patient would be liable on conviction, on information, to a fine not exceeding $3,000, up to a year in prison or both, and on summary conviction to a fine not exceeding $1,000, up to 6 months in prison or both. The updated bill, which was obtained by the Nassau Guardian, would establish an authority to lay out the framework of a medicinal marijuana industry in the Bahamas that would enable the licensed cultivation, importation, exportation, processing, retail, transportation, and research of medicinal cannabis. The bill also lists a retail license that would allow for the operation of a dispensary for the dispensing of medicinal cannabis products by a retailer who is not a licensed pharmacist. That is the news at 1 o'clock. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Thank you for tuning in. Stay tuned for updates on the hour. Have a great afternoon.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fooled with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't back down for nothing. So that means he got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you on?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. You gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, you know.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
All right, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say? I don't want nobody call me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know, and nobody gotta know it's you.
So how do I avoid?
All you gotta do is call them, or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me? Uh-uh.
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami, and they don't ask nothing about you. Then you can get the pin from them, and they can claim a reward later using that same pin.
Plus, everything's scrambled, so nobody can read what you said.
Calls 308-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to the Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. We're examining some of the government's policies announced yesterday in the 2021-2022 budget communication. Some of them I don't know if they're realistic. I'm not telling you don't take advantage of it. I'm saying I don't know that we're going to realize the outcomes that we projected, and that's going to put us in a problem in terms of our debt situation. All right? It says, Juan, it's the junkeneur's time. Well, and see, listen. What I'm saying is these people are watching you, right? So you can't say, I go into the World Bank for emergency money, and I go in through MIGA again for almost $900 million because things are so bad in the pandemic, but I give in to junkeneur's a $2 million headquarters. You see what I'm saying? These credit rating agencies are watching you. And they could tell when you ain't serious. Like, they're like, well, what are you talking about? Part of the emergency money is to fund the junkanoo? It says, while I'm building my apartment right now, the way I see it, the price is only going to get higher. Well, okay, that's fine. I don't know that I would take that bet, but that's fine. I mean, because when construction supply chains get going again, it's likely to drop. But I guess if you think they're going to be that high for a while, then a lot of people won't be able to afford to build anything. But for those of you who can, hopefully the offset in duty prices helps make up the hike in the cost. It says, spend $70 million on a new hospital, then turn Princess Margaret Hospital into nightclub 603. Again, you're not going to get much of a hospital for $70 million. Hey, Juan, there's little to debate as it pertains to where the government is focusing its tax breaks. I have $100 to buy a suitcase, and the clerk tells me I could buy Gucci slippers for $450. They cost $800, so how did that help me? Neither can I afford nor do I need those slippers. Yeah. This says this budget yesterday shows that this government is interested in giving Bahamians a hand up instead of a hand down. Teach a man how to fish instead of giving him a fish daily. The PLPs believe in borrowing money and giving out loose contracts to appease their supporters. Y'all ain't giving out contracts with all these millions of dollars y'all put inside this for new hires? That's not what y'all ain't, the FNM ain't hiring people with borrowed money, or I miss them? All right, let's look at this. Okay, so I need help, okay? I'm kind of dumb, so I need your help. I'm sincerely asking for your help. Explain to me how this works. Government offering tax incentives for hiring new employees. The government is incentivizing hiring for businesses by offering tax credits to cover the salaries of up to 10 new employees. Dr. Minnis said that it's expected to get 2,500 people back to work. Okay. The initiative will be up to $400 per week per employee. Employers will be able to begin reaping the benefits of this program from July 1. I think I know how it works, but I'm trying to figure out what exactly they're talking about. So where is the credit? Like, does that mean that you don't have to pay your business license? You get $400 credit per week for your business license payment. Where do you get the credit? Does that mean that you, if you collect $400 in VAT from consumers, you don't have to turn it over to the government? Where's the credit come from? They're going to give you back money? Because if you say I give you a credit that you don't have to pay so much for your business license, or you don't have to hand over the VAT, I don't understand. I don't understand how it works. All right? Because VAT is not something that a business actually pays out from its revenue. VAT is just something that a business turns over to the government because the customer paid the VAT. Do you get to not turn over the VAT money, or how does it work? Someone help me. I'm slow. All right. Now, you say this is going to lead up to 2,500 people to get jobs. All right. Now, am I going to hire someone at $400 per week? Well, let's look at it. Let's say I hire someone for $350, and then I got to pay the NIB, pay all that stuff like that. So the government's saying $400 per week per employee. They estimate it'll get 2,500 people back to work. Are you sure about that? Like, am I going to hire you and just have you there working? Do I have revenue coming in to take care of all the other costs that are associated with having a new employee, having several new employees? How does it work? Because if my business was robust enough, I would hire someone anyway. Is this something that the government even needs to do? Right? Because if I have robust business enough to need more people, I don't need the government's help. I'm making money. Is this where you're just saying that if you hire some, if you get put a new hire on, you don't have to turn over the VAT? Or that at the end of the year, they take it out of your business license fee? I'm sorry, you can call me, 323-6232, 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. This doesn't seem like a real thing to me, like that employers are saying, the only reason, let's take this phone call, employers are saying, the only reason they're not hiring people is because the government, I don't get it. I don't get it. If I need to hire someone, I need to hire someone. I don't need nothing from the government. But I guess if take advantage of it, if you're there. But I don't know how it creates 2,500 jobs. Hello. Good afternoon.
Good morning.
Hey, how's it going?
Well, have you ever heard of the trickle down economy? The trickle down effect of an economy.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah, any idea what that really supposed to mean as it relates to where does the money end up and where does the money begin?
It doesn't work. Yeah, it doesn't work as intended, I'll say that.
Well, what would you suggest that we attempt to, because it appears as though we in a situation where there are people who get the money first, like government get this, borrow this big lump sum of money, and then they decide how they're going to disburse it amongst their friends and the citizenry. Is there any way that we can track the money once government gets it and as to how where the money ends up? I'm going to have to hang up and listen to your response because I cannot hear you on the phone. May I do that, please?
Okay, sure. I mean, yeah, you could track where the money ends up. You could look at what government did in certain sectors, in certain areas, and track if you're increasing your revenue, track if you're increasing your economic activity. Central banks now doing quarterly reports. I would like them in a more timely fashion, but it's a good thing. So you could track it, certainly. The trickle-down thing, I think, at the end of the day, not enough trickles down. The wealthy get wealthier, and, you know, you do have an expansion. The expansion of capital in the world has led to the rise of salaries and standards of living throughout the globe, but it's also led to making some people obscenely rich, all right? While others are just still struggling to get by. So they don't let that much trickle down. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, good afternoon, Juan. What's up, man?
I'm great. How's it going?
Wonderful. Gregory Goldie the second, yeah.
Hi, how's it going?
Everything good, man. Good. Just wanted to help clarify, you know, the question you just asked with regards to VAT, the credit, and how it works.
Right.
Okay, so I own a small business, as you know, right? Mm-hmm. And what happens is we pay VAT, but we pay the VAT that we collect each month. Mm-hmm. Back to the government, and we can directly benefit from it because the funds that we pay the government every month, we could actually hire probably about 6 to 7 people with just the funds that we give to the government every month. And
but the VAT ain't yours though; it's just the VAT you collected.
No, understand right? But understand this one. Watch this. Okay, so we sell a product, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a dollar,
right?
But we actually only get 89 cents. But the customer is willing to pay a dollar for that product.
So you get to keep
89 cents goes to us, 11 cents goes to the government.
Okay.
We now can take that 11 cents
and keep it
and hire people with that. You
okay.
understand?
Okay. Okay.
So that's how we're able to benefit. And I'm not saying that every business is going to benefit, because you made a valid point.
What was preventing you from hiring more people?
Well, it's very expensive to run a business in the country, especially with the economy in the state that it's in right now.
Mm-hmm.
And what we want to do, what I can speak for my business is, what we're planning to do is expand our hours, because currently we're only open from 10:30 to 6 p.m.
Okay.
And we wanted to open earlier.
Excellent.
And so now we can use the funds that we were giving to the government, or collecting for the government and then transferring over to them. We can now use those funds to hire people so that we can expand our hours.
Okay, excellent.
You see?
So but you weren't going to hire people otherwise.
I was, but it would be more delayed, because, like I said, the economy is, you know, kind of in the trash right now. And so sales and stuff are down a bit. And so it wouldn't be the right time to hire, given the sales are down.
Right.
But
if government's going to give you the money, then you'll do it. Right, yeah.
Given this incentive, now we can go ahead and do that sooner. Because instead of giving the government $5,000-$6,000 a month, we can now pay people with those funds.
Okay. All right.
You see, so it does it, but I'm not saying that it's going to work for everybody. But I know for our business specifically, we found a way that we can benefit from it. And I wouldn't say that this is going to be a fix-all. I mean, there is, of course, more that can be done, but it is a step in the right direction.
Okay. I mean, I'm not saying it's not. I'm just saying I didn't get how it's going to work. But you've explained it to me, so that
right.
could
that's,
work.
Right. That's my understanding of how it's going to work. Because, you know, we do transfer a significant amount of cash over to the government every month for VAT.
So the government just says, keep the VAT money.
Yeah, if that money can be used to hire people, then that is a good thing, as opposed to just handing it over to the government.
Okay, for certain. Thank you.
All right, no problem.
Absolutely. More employment's a good thing. I'm just saying, are we realistic with what we're looking at? So you're not going to turn you get to keep $400 per week in VAT per employee. So if you're doing, 250 businesses, they take advantage of the opportunity to get up to 2,500 persons back to work. So $400, let's say 250 businesses hire 10 people, that's $4,000 per week per employee. All right. Well, maybe. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan.
How's it going?
All right, man. Question. In regard to the customs duty reduction on products that are sold, well, that are brought in.
Mm-hmm.
One of the concerns that I have with this budget and with any budget is the customer, the end user, hardly ever feels or sees the reduction of prices on the shelf in the stores by these companies or businesses who end up getting the customs duty reductions.
Mm-hmm.
How will the government ensure that if Joe Blow food store gets $1,000 worth of deductions?
They can't. I know where you're going. They can't.
Yeah, I mean, because
if I'm a business and you're already buying it for that price and you reduce the duty, why am I going to? I can increase my profit margin.
No, but that's a problem. You are supposed to pass that customs duty reduction to your business onto the customer.
Says who?
Natural law.
Natural law says goodness and kindness. If I could sell you a product for more money, I could sell it for more money.
Juan, I understand, you know, what it is to be in business and to earn a profit. But for God's sake, man, if the purpose is to help the economy, I mean, should not the customer also benefit from the help that the business is getting from government via that customs reduction?
The only way you'll do that is to price control everything.
Yeah, well, that's probably where they need to step in and step up to the plate big time, because it makes no sense to me as the customer to hear the government saying that there's going to be customs duty to the business, but I do not see the reduction in that price reflected in the price on the shelf.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for example, gas stations, whenever prices go down, usually, I mean, on the international market, usually prices go down at the pumps.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It should be passed on to the customers in every instance, Vaughn. Otherwise, to me, it is only leading to continuing greed by the business owners, those who unfortunately do have the tendency to be greedy. Thank you, man.
Now, keep in mind that if you're taking that off the item, you're going to see, you're going to pay less money at the cash register. So keep that in mind. All right? This says, good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, good afternoon, Juan.
How's it going?
Juan, yes. First thing, right? Mm-hmm. People like to call businesses greedy, but also you have to understand that government is also sticking it to the businesses also.
Well,
so
you,
despite,
right, I mean,
despite them lowering the custom duty on certain things, they also hike the duty on imports and all other things like that also.
Well, listen.
On one hand, you lower the duty on certain stuff for businesses. On the other hand, you stick in businesses with higher taxes. So what do you think going to happen?
I don't think the government should get in the business of regulating the price of everything. Okay?
Exactly.
So, because where does that end? You know what I mean?
Exactly. So when you have the paid port, when port fee goes up, import fee, when all sorts of different fees go up that the public do not see, when you import something, when the shipping fee goes up, what do you think going
to
happen?
But people are in business to make money, though. It's
exactly.
Illogical to go, well, since you're charging less tax, make less money. No, we're going to keep more money to expand our business. And you know
exactly.
What I mean? That's what
not
I did this
for. Not because the government lowered the duty on something. That means that the store is going to automatically lower the duties on, I mean, the prices in their store because they have other taxes they have to pay also, and light bill and all those different things that goes up.
And they've also probably suffered some economic contraction during the pandemic, and they're looking to gain some ground, you know?
Exactly. And also, in a climate like this, when the government scrapped for cash, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where are they going to replace all these duties when they, I mean, like, how are they giving out all these concessions? How are they going to replace it? Because, I mean, if we're already in a hole,
yeah, well,
and
they
we're not
have
collecting sufficient revenue, and God forbid a hurricane hit us.
Yeah, they have some.
So a hurricane come this year. We just at the beginning of a hurricane season.
Yeah, let's not hope.
Well, I guess then is a possibility.
Let's not do. If I never see another hurricane again, I'd be really
right.
Happy.
So what I'm saying is that how are they going to replace all of this that they're giving away? Because all they're doing is projecting. They're not. That's not money in their pocket.
Right. Well,
they're just projecting what they want to collect without thinking about what could happen.
Yep. I mean, so, and that's life, you know. Sometimes you get hit with shocks, but it's an ambitious thing. And if a shock does happen, it's going to be a problem.
So it's going to be a serious problem for us. Yeah. We'd be in a deeper hole, God forbid. I don't understand it. So we need to understand how is it that the government is going to replace all of this that they're talking about. They're talking about Airbnb, but I mean, the tourist hasn't arrived as yet, so we're projecting so much money from Airbnb, but we're really, I mean.
Well, that's the thing. What do you see that demand there that you're really going to realize that from the Airbnb is my question. And what can you show me that says that that's a real thing outside of, because the World Tourism Organization don't see it.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So we're projecting these things. We're going to say collect this amount of money from Airbnb, but the tourists didn't start coming yet, like, and that large number to even consider collecting that type of money. So,
I got you.
We need to know how is it that they're going to collect these funds, keep the economy going. How is it?
Yeah, I'm with you. You got to, you know, and it's all projections. But my thing is, be realistic with your projections because you haven't been meeting them, right? But you've been missing them by a lot, right? So, for instance, you're off by $100 million for this year, right? If, when you look at the budget, you're off $100 million from your projection. Now, I know, small amount of money. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
You're off $100 million.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, I'm great. How's it going?
Good. Juan?
Yes. Hi.
Hey, I'm Juan Anna.
Yes, you are. Yes.
All right, sorry about that. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and good afternoon to you and the Bahamian public. I just have 5 points, and I promise I will be off after I said there should be 30 seconds per minute.
Okay.
So the points that I wanted to emphasize is the government is, we are reaping what we have sown over the years, 40-something years of independence, and even prior to that. Mm-hmm. So we are now seeing that. I don't know if you were old enough to remember panel used to be on Prince Shock's CCP.
Yeah, yeah.
He kept echoing violence the budget. Mm-hmm. But we ignored him. We thought he was, something was wrong with him.
Right.
You know, now and then, there's no debt relief in sight. Unless some drastic measures like reducing the public service, selling off corporations, which you said earlier, there is no debt relief in sight. This is continuing, it's going to continue to climb. We don't have natural resources that generate significant income, revenue, so we are in a desperate situation. The government also needs to introduce new taxes, such as corporate or income. I don't hear no one saying that, and I don't expect the wealthy to say that, but the government is not willing to do that because a lot of them are wealthy. So they're not going to tax themselves. They're going to wait till they get in the hand of the IMF, and it has to be done. So why they don't just be wise enough to do it, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, this may all end up with the IMF, yeah. So, but I say this may all end up with us dealing with the IMF in a serious way, but, you know.
And that's the unfortunate thing. You know, we need to tell the truth as well to the Bahamian public that, you know, the future is a bleak future. I have four kids. The future is very bleak in terms of what the dollar today or the dollar yesterday could have purchased and what it's going to purchase in the future. It's very bleak for this country.
Yeah.
We don't print money. We don't have no additional. And then lastly, we need to stop the cronyism, like digging up sidewalks that we didn't need to. Why waste all that money? We don't need to have buildings that we don't we're renting at such high rates from persons. There's so much wastage that's just going. They say they're going to build a new airport, but that doesn't make sense. Or airports, does it really make sense when you're in this desperate state? Shouldn't you focus on the low-hanging fruits in terms of really trying to generate income? And those are the points I just wanted to touch on. Thanks so much.
Okay, appreciate you. Now, I've got a few more calls. I want to talk about the VAT on the real estate stuff, too. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan. Good afternoon to you and the voice.
Hey, how's
it going? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Maybe 30 seconds at most. One, you know, I don't know if you hear it. I think I hear that thing, that organization, which you call it CDC or something in America.
Uh-huh.
They sound like they was given permission or telling these people who we make this agreement with, Royal Caribbean Cruise.
Mm-hmm.
They telling them that they could start testing, starting somewhere in June. So I know they make an agreement, Royal Caribbean, to make one agreement with us.
Right, yeah, home board.
And I think it only lasts for 6 months. I think they're doing it with other Caribbean countries, too. So I was wondering if they're getting back home to Florida or they could continue to do it with us, because I think it was a good idea for the government to get an agreement to do something like that. I don't know what the government have to give away for that. I think it should have been longer than 6 months. And one, do you know, maybe if you have papers to Guardian or someone, you know, is there any truth that we're supposed to be having a national lottery start somewhere in June and one of the web shop owners supposed to be running it for the government? Because we is agitating for many years for a national lottery and for the government to be in charge of it and let someone manage it. I'll hang up and listen. Thanks.
Okay. I know nothing about the national lottery, and as far as I'm aware, the home porting is still on track. Okay, so the government's doing a couple of things with VAT on property. So one of the things is that they're making now VAT on the total value of the Airbnb rental, right? Or the vacation rental by owner and the commission as well. I don't have an issue with that. My only issue would be if you're really going to realize that $31 million number, all right? If you pay VAT on a hotel room, you should probably pay VAT on the Airbnb. There's an argument, and I was on it. I was listening to it for a while that, well, don't kill the thing before it has a chance to grow, et cetera. But also, you know, if you're making that money, you know what I mean? The hotel's got to pay it. I think you should also pay the VAT. We gonna need the VAT. No, will you get the $31 million? I don't know. All right. I don't know. Another thing the government is doing is it is increasing VAT on real estate transactions valued over $2 million. All right? I got no problem with that. Okay? That's fine. Now, are you going to yield that additional $4 million? Don't know. Right? That's what you say. You say a lot of things. Right? Now, something else the government is doing, I think, could be a problem and might end up in court. The Prime Minister said yesterday that they're introducing legislative amendments to improve real property tax collections for commercial properties. He said, we've had situations where owners of significant commercial properties collect substantial rent from businesses but are delinquent in the payment of taxes. The legislative enhancements will permit the government to have those rents paid to the Department of Inland Revenue for delinquent commercial property tax owners. Okay. You're going to have legislation to where the rent is seized, yes, and sent to the government. Now, question, how are they going to pay their mortgage at the same time if you're taking the rent money to satisfy the real property tax bill outstanding? Because we could be talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars here and a prolonged period of seizing this rent. How do you know these properties won't have mortgage defaults? How do you know banks won't take issue with that? I think that the mechanism now where you could take these commercial property owners to court is perhaps better than doing this. This could cripple some people. Many people. I don't know that that's a good idea. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Juan.
How's it going?
All is well. A lot of previous callers that said that teachers for the Bahamas, and I guess I'll have to disagree with that because I think the future is bleak, and as far as we decide on what kind of leadership we as citizens are going to be prepared to have, I'll never forget something I heard Vincent Van der Poel Wallace said once. He said, if you always do what you always did, you'll always get what you always got. Mm-hmm. And I think we have been doing the same thing over and over and over again and continue to expect a different result. I'm not in favor of income tax simply because of the high cost base that things are. And I don't think that we're going to automatically see a reduction in prices because of the removal of import duties on certain products or all products. Because we saw, I think, when Prime Minister Ingram removed the duties on fruit, and for maybe about 6 months, the cost of those fruits and strawberries and blueberries went down. And slowly they creeped right back up to the same prices they were when they actually carried a duty. And so I think it's just going to be us deciding on whether we're going to settle for innovative leadership and new ideas and maybe even a new set of people to carry out those ideas and solutions. But current path that we're on in terms of doing the same thing and switching every 5 years is definitely not going to be the solution for us long term. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, my friend. I could get with income tax, like at a certain level. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, Vaughn.
Hey, how's it going?
I was given the permission by your producer to call back to make a quick rebuttal.
Sure, go ahead.
I was just simply saying in regards to the customs reduction, as I've seen prices go up in the food store when the customs duty was added, I would like to see the prices in the food store come down naturally, not taking away from the profit margin of the business person, because if I were in business, I would want to make a fair profit margin too. But I'm simply saying if the customer has to bear the burden of prices when they go up for whatever reason, they should be given the consideration of lower and consistently lower prices in the food stores, in the furniture store, etc., when the prices go down because of duty reduction. It doesn't happen that way.
No.
But it's only fair to happen that way. You know, a lot of Bahamians were chased off to shopping in Florida
many years ago. Why? Because the prices at home were so high, they found it more beneficial to themselves to go and shop abroad. And I believe that if the prices were more reasonable over here at the time and even now, more Bahamians might have shopped and spent that money right in the Bahamian economy and grew those businesses that actually suffered because of the prices, I mean, the money spent abroad.
Yeah.
So I'm just asking the business owners
to be fair,
to be considerate of the customer. Don't kill the goose that lays your golden egg. And right now, we, the customers, if we boycott or stop supporting any business, that business would crash and it would close. Thank you, buddy.
All right. Appreciate you. I understand. You feel pressure with the pricing. I get that. But again, you know, I'm never going to be on board with the government controlling the price of everything. There's a number of things that are already VAT-free, and that's a good move, so we don't pay it at the cash register. But, I hear you, but I just can't get there. This says, Juan, can you imagine a renter paying funds to government and not their landlord, only for the government to say they have no record of the payment? Do they really want to put themselves in the midst of a landlord-tenant dispute? Boy, that's a drastic move, I got to say. That is a drastic move. It says, Super Juan McCartney, a show that offers good hope to all men. The FNM says, get your own life jacket, make preparations. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Juan, what do you suggest since you're so critical? Okay. Well, okay. So for the purposes of today, we're not trafficking in fantasy. We're trafficking in reality. So whatever I would suggest is not going to change if the government's borrowing another $1 billion. Whatever I suggest is not going to change that the actual projection of government debt is $10.4 billion. It ain't going to change the tax breaks. It ain't going to change if they seize your rent money. Nothing I suggest is going to change that. I'm just looking at what's going on. So what I suggest is immaterial to the discussion that we're having today. We are examining and analyzing what is happening, what the government says it will do and is about to go do in about a month. It says income tax for what? To give the ZNS a bomb. No, in my imaginary income tax scenario, the Bahamas Air and ZNS are private entities. This exemption should increase to $1,000. I mean, for the stuff? For the customs exemption? This says, no third world country has stayed out of the hands of the IMF and the World Bank. Please read The Great Reset. It paints the global list agenda and geopolitical transnational financial outlook. I ain't scared about the IMF. Now, it don't look good because everybody, you know what I mean? But I'm not scared about it. Yeah, so anything I might suggest really isn't going to do anything today. All right. And to the extent that the government's off in these things, it's going to be a worse scenario. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon. Good afternoon. Are you there?
Hello. Yes, I'm here. How are you?
I'm great. How's it going?
Okay, I just want to put in a 0.05 cents.
Sure.
Everybody is calling in from what I can hear and accusing the businesses of not lowering the price when the duty drops. I think that's irresponsible. Yes, some businesses, let's say at least in my opinion, 80% of the businesses will drop their price, reduce their price based on the reduction in duty. You have the couple who may not, but you can't blame everybody for not dropping their price. That's wrong.
Yeah, I agree. You don't know the circumstance of everyone. And plus, again, if it's VAT free, then you won't see it at the register, which is helpful, right? Because I look every time on my receipt to see what's VAT free and not. Some things don't make sense that they're tax free, but I'll take it. This says, Juan, can you say whether the tax break of 50% is being extended beyond May 31st? I don't know. I'll double check that. The real property tax break? Yeah, you may want to go do that too, particularly if you're a commercial property owner in arrears at Inland Revenue, because they're coming for your rent money. So you might want to square that away. You get 50% off. I'd go make that happen. You got a couple of days. Let's take a break. We'll be right back.
Thomas Wesson Truck Company Limited, we provide vehicles known for quality and durability. From the iconic Jeep Wrangler to the award-winning Grand Cherokee, we've got your everyday driver covered. For larger tasks, our Ram 1500, Mitsubishi Fuso Canter Trucks, CMC Verica Vans, and Fuso Rosa Jitneys do way more than just deliver. We even carry a wide variety of pre-owned vehicles. To keep you going, our parts, service department, and body shop can accommodate our brands and others. Call us today at 322-1722 or email info@bahamasbus.com.
Calling all Primo fans! Marco's Pizza's got a new special. That's right, the trio deal was made just for you. Enjoy one large, one topping pizza, cheesy bread, and a 2-liter soda for just $20. At Marco's Pizza, we're all about quality. That's why we make our dough fresh every day. Our specials are hot, delicious, and affordable. Three items, just $20. Order your trio deal today on our website, MarcosPizzaBahamas.com. Marcos, every store, every day, the Italian way. Hello, Primo.
Here's what you can expect when it's your turn to be vaccinated. After registering online, you will show up at your selected vaccination center on the appointed date and time. Remember to carry your ID along with your confirmation code for verification. Next, you will sanitize your hands and have your temperature checked before checking in and joining the queue. When it is your turn, you will be directed to a vaccination station and a healthcare provider will fill out your vaccine information card and administer the vaccine. You will then be sent to an observation area where you will wait for 15 minutes and be monitored for signs of any adverse reaction. In the case of emergencies, vaccine sites are equipped with an emergency setup where a doctor is on standby. After the 15-minute wait, you are free to go. Be sure to monitor any symptoms over the next few weeks and remember to schedule your second dose within 8 to 12 weeks. It's your choice, your chance to protect yourself. Register to get vaccinated for COVID-19 today at vax.gov.bs.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
Preparing for a hurricane can make all the difference in safeguarding the lives of family, friends, and neighbors. By knowing what action you should take, you can reduce the effects of a hurricane disaster. Get all the facts of the potential of having insurance, impact-resistant windows, home emergency power, essential supplies, and a lot more before the storm. After the storm, where to purchase building or cleaning supplies, waste disposal, medical care, and more. The Nassau Guardians Hurricane Guide will help you make sure everyone knows what to do in the event a hurricane approaches. Take advantage of this double insertion opportunity plus 15 commercials on Star 106 hits. Contact us today at 302-2300. That's 302-2300 or your account executive. Will you be prepared?
Samantha's always on point. She doesn't miss a thing. When she signs up for any insurance policy, she reads all the fine print. She knows what's covered, what's not covered, and she's aware of her deductibles. When it comes to insurance, it pays to know your policy. Review every insurance policy so you know what you're covered for. This message was brought to you by the Insurance Commission of the Bahamas.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality. We'll be right back.
to the revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. So good to have you with us. All right, so we're examining some of the things. There's still not a lot of things. We didn't touch on digitization, which I think actually is excellent. All right, so I give the Minutes Administration a great deal of kudos for executing the digitization strategy that has been worked out with the IDB. They weren't the first to initiate it, but it's been successive, but they've done very well with it so far, in my estimation. All right, with that. And that's really helped. I think the pandemic has sped that up. And I think that the need to step into the 21st century has also sped that up. But it's great that it's being done. All right. Juan, do you remember during COVID when multiple Bahamians were screaming about the government stopping collections from Western Union and Cash and Go? They basically seized private money. The majority of Bahamians were saying, yeah, block it, because too many people send money to Haiti. I texted Guardian and I asked, I wonder what they'll say when the government stops collection from their bank account. And here we are. The writing on the wall is be so clear to me. I mean, it's not the same thing, but it is a demonstration of, you know, the government exercising its might. I think, you know, maybe a little overzealously with that one. Good day, McCartney. The cost of essential items, food, pharmaceuticals, and building supplies in the Bahamas are controlled by monopolies. Without competition, prices will not change in spite of reductions in government taxes. Well, you know, it's hard to create artificial competition. That's something that's kind of got to be, that happens organically most times. Juan, all of these government incentives, all it does is make it a government shortfall. Juan, we have to tax the rich or do a corporate tax, big business. Juan, nobody talks about getting good interest on our loans. I mean, listen, they're expensive loans, and maybe that's the best you could get overseas. You probably could have done better here. You saw the need to do that very heavily in the U.S. I question that, but, you know. Well, I'm trying to understand this VAT, this tax credit thing, too. When the businesses use the VAT funds to hire staff, wouldn't this reduce VAT revenue? Yeah, it's going to reduce VAT revenue. Yeah. The prime minister said $40 million. So let me do this math real quick. He says 2,500 people. And that'd be great if you can get 2,500 people back to work. So that's $1 million. So he says the government's going to lose $40 million, so he anticipates 40 weeks of employment? I'm not sure. Because these are full-time employees, yes? Or maybe he thinks that everyone won't get the full 400, and therefore there's more, it could cover 52 weeks and not be $1 million a week. Okay, a few more texts, and then we gotta bounce. The government also regulates in prices everything by setting an ungodly interest rate. The Bahamas is a RIP country. That's not super clear to me. It says Juan, why don't they remove VAT from fruits and vegetables? Yeah, they should. It says, is it true that Island Luck is giving... I don't know what Island Luck's doing. You're barking up the wrong tree. I don't play numbers. I'm so sorry. It says, hi, Juan. Was anything included in the budget to do anything immediately with the east end of Bay Street in anticipation of the return of tourism through eminent domain, perhaps? Not that I saw. Not anything that was announced. Why isn't Eleuthera on the free trade zone list? It should be. It says, Juan, it will be the PLP's problem. It says, take the loan money and enter into contracts with farmers and fishermen to buy their produce from the packing house and give vouchers to the packing house for people who are in hard times. Okay. It says, dude, I like to listen to you on the radio, but you need to stop your crap. Give the Prime Minister some credit. You always carry on like a hater. Did he promise you something? No, he didn't promise me anything. I ain't no hater. I don't think he's good at his job. I just gave him credit for digitization. What you want? Like, you know, rub him down with some oil? I don't, what is it? Critically analyzing the budget. I don't think he's a good Prime Minister. I don't think he knows what he's doing in finance. That's, what do you want me to pretend that I don't feel that way? That's my feeling. If you feel he's doing great, great. You know, I don't have to be your surrogate to give him credit where you think credit is due. You go ahead. Go send him an email. OPM at bs.gov. Good afternoon. Does the VAT exemption stipulate that employers pay at least minimum wage and NHI for all employees and that all government taxes and business fees are up to date? Yes. Yes. Well, he didn't say you have to get at least minimum wage yesterday, but you legally can't pay anyone below minimum wage. But this is for full-time employees. It says, I would never use VAT collected revenue in my business unless I've paid more VAT than I've collected. This is an accounting nightmare. I have a separate account to place the VAT money. Your business is just a conduit. Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, that might get tricky. Give the Prime Minister credit for what? That's my question. What, tell me what I should give him credit for. Explain it to me. For borrowing money? Is that, he should be congratulated? For spending the money, he should be congratulated? What has he done that's worthy of credit? I'd love to know. It says, good afternoon, Juan. When will diversification be mentioned? Agriculture, fisheries? They say they're going to do some agriculture, but no major investments announced. So the caveat is that employers must first be up to date with NIB. Few will be eligible. It's like the mortgage relief plan. Only half a dozen get benefit. Yeah, I mean, you got to be up to date. It says, you know, Anton's going to call to rebut that wise caller on hiring more employees. Man, if you could hire more employees, then go ahead. That'd be a good thing. Is it something that's actually going to work the way they say it's going to work? I don't know. But if that helps your business, then take advantage of it, and that's a good thing for your business. My concern is that these things actually translate to what we're looking at in the overall budget, because you will have to borrow what you don't realize in economic generation from these incentives. The government $400 a week incentive business is nothing more than the government hiring more people because they will be paying the salary, more current expenditure disguised as incentive, more government employees using up wealth. I mean, look, it's either way, right? So either you keep, I pay the business the VAT and the business uses the VAT to pay the employee, or I pay the government the VAT and the VAT hires, I pay the VAT to the government and the government hires people. It's either way. All right. Okay, we got to go. Shivargo Lang's up next with Z-Live off the record. We didn't get to everything, but, you know, hey, budget's a big document. So sometimes I like to go through the heads and kind of see what's there. We may do that exercise as well. All right, so you guys take care out there and have a great day, Bahamas.